I've been studying the early church, as you know, and many of them were very strict vegetarians. I prayed to God to like healthier foods in the summer of 2015, and he helped me with that. And then I started getting convicted about eating unclean foods. And then I started getting convicted about eating red meat. By that point, I only ate chicken and egg and cheese, but that's not quite an animal. But definitely not vegan. Then I was praying for what I should eat at each meal. And I realized after a while, I was eating less and less meat until I wasn't eating any at all. I went to my dad's remarriage to my stepmother, and they had meat there. I don't think it was chicken, but I didn't think that there was anything in the Bible against eating meat. So I figured I could have eaten it, as I was hungry, and he wouldn't have had me not eat it, right? But I ended up not. I ended up eating only chips and potatoes. It really wasn't much to eat. Not much of a meal. But declining the meat at that point was really kind of the no return for me. The point of no return. I figured, I guess this is it. Just no more meat. I'm not doing this video to teach you to stop eating meat. I'm explaining that I was led to give up meat after I prayed to have healthier foods be more appetizing to me. So now I'm just explaining that and explaining what I'm studying from the early followers of Yahshua. I was convicted by the Holy Spirit, in my opinion, to stop eating meat. Now I know some people might say that it wasn't the Holy Spirit that got me to stop eating meat. It was an antichrist or demonic spirit that did that. The word holy means of God or separate from human infirmity, impurity, and sin. So the question is eating meat separate from human infirmity, impurity, and sin, and of God? Genesis 1, verse 29. And God said, Behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed, which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree, and the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat, and to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. And it was so. In Genesis, God created the earth, and it was good. And it's interesting that now today, when we hear the word meat, we think flesh of animals. But the word meat in this time period of translating the King James Bible, the word meat was used for all foods. So whenever you see the word meat in the Bible, please be sure to check the definition of the word in the original text before assuming it means flesh rather than just any kind of food like berries or something. Because obviously God was saying that, you know, it was the seed, the fruits that were to be for our food, our meat. You know, it wasn't animals. Animals and humans were eating the same thing. The seeds and the berries and things like that. And we can clearly see here that every creature was to eat all that and not each other. Not eating animals is what is free from human infirmity, impurity, and sin, because that is what their diet was before there was sin. And it was of God and it was good. So yes, not eating meat is definitely holy. The Holy Spirit gets you to be holy, set apart, different. Free from infirmity, impurity, and sin. That's what the Holy Spirit is there for. And so food and meat were synonyms in the past. And this is another example of a method of witchcraft in changing the definition of a word to influence people. You might wonder, how is this change of a word in the text of the Bible today? 1 Timothy 4:1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meat, which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing to be refused, if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer. If Paul was going against the teachings of Yahweh and saying all foods are now considered clean, then he was a false prophet. Yet many people still go to these verses to say that they can eat all meat. Now, the word in verse 3 is broma, which means food. But there are many articles online explaining he seems to be saying that everything that God created to be received was worthy of being eaten, which would mean any of the clean meats God allowed would be able to be eaten and shouldn't be outlawed by people. Paul seems to be saying that you can eat any creature of God as long as you pray over it. And I know many people who will take this verse to mean just that and pray over their bacon, as I was trying to do. I also noticed that when I went through my deliverance and the demons wanted to keep a hold of me, they had me eating more bacon than usual. I, of course, didn't know that at the time. I thought that we were able to eat unclean meats now at that time. But looking back, I understand that that's what they were trying to do, keep a legal right to harass me and make me do as many things as they could so that they would have that legal right. And bacon is one of those things. Paul is either extremely hard to understand or he's a false prophet. If you understand him to be undoing the Torah, then he's a liar too. Romans 2 verse 12. For as many as have sinned without law shall also perish without law, and as many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. Paul said it was those who do the law that are justified. And the law is also about not eating unclean meats. It has not been done away with, as Jesus said that the law would not be done away with as long as the heavens and the earth are still here, and they still are. So, Paul either lied or he is against unclean meats too. Since I've been studying and discussing if God never wanted sacrifices, and that it was perhaps a man-made tradition that was added later, one of the questions that comes up concerning it is, if God never wanted sacrifices, why did he declare some clean and unclean meats? Some of the early followers of Yahushua believed that Moses or others knew the people were too entrenched in the pagan ways of sacrifices and meat-eating, and that they said, just do it to Yahweh, not to other gods, until the Messiah would come and do away with it altogether. You can see the playlist, Jesus Came to Abolish Sacrifices, if you haven't yet, for more information. Some of them just said that it wasn't that Moses said it was okay, they just added it. But that could be one thing, is that Moses just said it was okay and just, you know, they went along with that. So, since the people were doing it anyway, then God told them which meats to choose from and which not to. We know they are healthy, and they probably didn't know how healthy the unclean meat was back then. So it seems to be like a divine ruling on what to eat and what not to eat. God wanted them to be set apart and holy so other nations would look at them and wonder why they were so much healthier than they are. Why were the Israelites so much more blessed? If you do God's will, people should see God at work in your life. Remember, they were told to come in Yahweh's name. Jesus said, I come in my Father's name. And sadly, most people think that he's the only one to do so. But no, the commandments tell us to take Yahweh's name. They say just don't take his name in vain. To take his name is to take his characteristics on, his likeness. We're all supposed to take his name, but when we sin, we take it in vain and break the commandment. Jesus didn't. He was always in the same name or characteristics of Yahweh, his Father. If they would have kept their Father's commandments, they would have looked like their Father, holy and set apart from the rest of the world, and the rest of the world would have been jealous. But the Israelites kept conforming to the world rather than getting separate. The people who followed Yahushua did not conform to the world. They weren't set apart. They didn't eat meat. They bathed every day as a reminder of their baptism, a renewal of their death to their sins. We die daily to our sins, so we don't do them anymore. I full-heartedly believe that they were living life like they didn't have to sin, which there's most of the world thinks they have to sin these days. I just don't believe they thought that. Romans 6:1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, Even so, we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. But if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more, death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it and the lust thereof. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God, as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. Many Christians have no idea what being under the law means today. In Galatians 5, he goes through the fruits of the Spirit and the fruits of the flesh. They war against each other. So you should be working with the help of the Holy Spirit to get rid of all the fruits of the flesh from your body, choosing to die daily to those and be baptized daily into the Spirit, so you will show the fruits of the Spirit each day instead. It's a daily thing. Galatians 5, verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. For if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. Notice there is no law against the fruits of the Spirit. If you are led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law, as verse 18 says. You are not under the law when you are showing fruits of the Spirit, and you have no fruits of the flesh. Instead, you're fulfilling the law when you agape love everyone. So these earlier followers of Yahshua were dying daily to any sin and living daily in the Spirit, free from demons, from past sins, which means free to do God's will and show God's love to everyone. When you saw them, you saw a holy people, a set-apart people. The thing most people have issue with concerning this idea that Yahweh never wanted sacrifices, and Yahshua was telling them to do away with the sacrifices, is the fact that the Bible has so many instances where it talks about sacrifices, like the Passover lamb, the ram when Abraham went to sacrifice Isaac. The biggest is usually, what does it mean for Jesus' death? But people have the wrong idea of Jesus' death. The Bible states it was Jesus' obedience to God his whole life to the death that saved us, not the blood, but the resurrection of Jesus. God raised him up because he was completely obedient. In Revelation, Jesus tells us, if we are obedient and overcome like he did, we will sit on the same throne as him. False doctrines are like spider webs in your mind. If someone thinks Jesus is God, then they have to believe that he left his body and raised it back up after 3 days. Then they believe in the eternal soul doctrine because they say Jesus' soul left his body. Then they believe in the eternal conscious punishment in hellfire because they believe in eternal souls. Also, since they believe Jesus is God, they believe that God had to shed his own blood to save us from himself, which makes no sense. Since the Bible says, by a man's disobedience we died, but by a man's obedience we live. But they get spiritually blinded. Just one bad doctrine is enough, but when you have so many of them, they cloud your brain so that you can't think logically anymore. We have to ask God to help us to not be deceived, and to clear out the cobwebs to see clearly. I believe that's what's going on with myself this past year, whether you believe it or not. I always say people should pray to God to not be deceived by anybody, including myself. But I know you can't get people to stop believing in eternal souls if they think Jesus is God, because they think Jesus had an eternal soul, rather than believing God raised him from the dead. You can't get people to stop believing in eternal hellfire damnation if they believe in eternal souls. And you can't get people to believe Jesus didn't shed God's blood when they think Jesus is God. The whole idea of Jesus needing to shed his blood to save us is not what the Bible seems to focus on. It talks more about Jesus' obedience and his resurrection. It mentions having the faith of Jesus, not faith in Jesus. Romans 3, verse 22, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. People who think Jesus is God tend to forget that we're told to have the faith of Jesus. Jesus, being a man, had a lot of faith to go to his death and not argue, even though he was innocent, to try to save his life. Basically, if people think Jesus is God, they really need him to be sacrificed for their sins, because they don't want to stop sinning themselves. They don't want to accept that Jesus' death didn't cover their sins, and that they still have to get rid of those. It seems to me that any verses that are talking about us being saved by blood are either corrupt or we're just not understanding it the way that they were supposed to be used. Jesus told us how to inherit eternal life, and it wasn't waiting for him to die. He said keep the commandments. John preached repentance, and Jesus agreed. We are to die to our sin and repent of it and be baptized and born again of God following the Holy Spirit's convictions. The punishment for our sin is death, and we all die. And the punishment for our sin is condemnation that is currently happening. John 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten, a special son, that whoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation. The light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. We were all condemned already. The punishment is currently in progress all around the earth. The reason some people who think Jesus saved us by his blood think that the Jews aren't saved and everybody who died before Jesus wasn't saved is because of this faulty doctrine. Faulty doctrines turn into false conclusions. People were saved before Jesus came. Romans 3-4 and Hebrews 11 talk all about the faith of people who live before Jesus were saved. Of course, we know faith without works is dead. If you don't have works, then you don't really have faith. The more works you have shows how much faith you have. Are you ready to give up all your spare time to do God's will, having faith only and being rewarded in the age to come rather than this age? How much you give up shows how much you have faith that you will truly be rewarded one day, but not now. As for those who say, but we couldn't be blameless before Jesus came and washed us clean with blood. And check out the first chapter of Luke concerning John the Baptist's conception. Before Jesus was ever born, Luke 1, verse 5, there was, in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias, and of course, of the course of Abia, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of Yahweh, blameless. People argue you couldn't possibly keep the commandments of God before Jesus came. No, but here we have it. They were both keeping his commandments and ordinances, and they were blameless. So, did they need Jesus to die so that they could stop sinning? Obviously not. Now, even people who think Jesus saved them but continue to live in sin are living in darkness. And you can see my video, Crime and Punishment, for more on that. But basically, demons are currently harassing and or spiritually blinding them due to this sin, so they are still in darkness. The cobwebs I mentioned earlier. They're being deceived by demons, even into believing that they don't have to get rid of the sin that they are currently committing to be freed from those demons. So why did Jesus die? That's not the point of this video, but it's obvious to me that they didn't need his blood to be spilled to be considered righteous and blameless, and to be quote-unquote saved. We have to believe what he said, and do what he said, which is to keep God's commandments. That's what Jesus told us to do to get eternal life. From Chris's post today on Facebook, I think I'm finally understanding why Jesus died. He prophesied his death would be like the sign of Jonah. As Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the whale, so too would Christ be 3 days in the earth. When reading Matthew 12, where this is spoken of, it was Jesus rebuking Pharisees. He said, "Only an evil generation asks for a sign." And he called his death a sign to them, an evil act. What did he say that sign was for? Blood atonement? Forgiveness of sins? No, he said it was to prove to the world he was a true prophet of God, and his message of repentance, not blood sacrifice, is what saves us. It was the same in the story of Jonah, where he preached repentance to Nineveh, and it was their hearts that changed. No death or blood required. End quote. So Jesus said we're supposed to keep his commandments. That was his message. Repent and keep God's commandments if you love him. So people don't like to accept that. I'm not here to quote-unquote teach it. You should always pray to God to not be deceived and to be led to the truth and study to show yourself approved to God. What you believe is between you and God. I don't mind either way. The Bible does talk about us being judged by our work, no matter if we are quote-unquote saved or not, in the end. Now, I don't do these videos to get likes, shares, keep my subs subbed, or anything like that. I just wanted to know more, so I'm studying. Why is it that Paul seems to be saying that we're saved by Jesus' death and the blood spilled, when the rest of the Bible says people are saved by faith in his resurrection? Maybe he was just hard to understand. I'm still studying it, but I do know Jesus told us how to be saved by following the Ten Commandments. And we're going to have works that show how much faith we have. That's what they did in the Old Testament. Why is it named Old Testament anyway? Is there a New Testament? The word for testament means covenant. Is there mention of a new covenant in the Old Testament? Yes, there is. In Jeremiah 31, verse 31, "Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith Yahweh. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith Yahweh, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it on their hearts. It will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know Yahweh. For they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith Yahweh. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." The new covenant or testament is that Yahweh's law is written on our hearts, and we will know Yahweh. We know Yahweh when we do his will and let him work through us. The people who believe Jesus died to take away the punishment of their sins believe that it was his death that did this. That's why Jeffrey Dean has a whole video series on why Jesus is the Antichrist beast of Revelation. They turn Jesus into a beast to be sacrificed for them so that they can be free from trying to stop sinning. They will claim that they won't use it as a license to sin, but then they will turn around and say, "But you can't be without sin. It's not possible," they say. So by thinking they have to sin, they know they are going to sin, and it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. The spots on the leopard beast won't change. They will always be seen with sin. Spots and blemishes are they. mainstream Christianity has turned Jesus into a beast to be slayed for them. People teach the Bible is all about the priests offering up sacrifices of animals to God for the forgiveness of sins, and now Jesus is our final forgiveness. But that's not what they taught in the Bible. Was sacrificial atonement necessary to be saved from death? Job 19, verse 23. Oh, that my words were now written. Oh, that they were printed in a book. That they were graven with an iron pen and lead in the rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. But ye should say, why persecute we him, seeing the root of the matter is found in me? Be ye afraid of the sword, for wrath bringeth the punishment of the sword, that ye may know there is a judgment. Job's considered the oldest book in the Bible. He was expecting that even after he died and became worm food, God would raise him from the dead in his exact same body. It would not be another's body. It would not be somebody else's eyes. It would be his body. He mentioned his Redeemer, but he mentions his Redeemer liveth, which I believe to be a reference to the living God Yahweh, not Jesus. Yahweh was called the living God because he was always alive from the beginning to the end, because he created everything. He's everlasting. He is the Alpha and the Omega. Not like the pagan gods of wood and stone that could not speak because they were dead idols. Isaiah 26 also speaks of the resurrection and gives a better idea on how the prophets believe people got to get into the millennium kingdom. The verse concerning the resurrection is Isaiah 26 verse 19. But your dead will live, Yahweh, their bodies will rise. Let those who dwell in the dust wake up and shout for joy. Your dew is like the dew of the morning. The earth shall give birth to her dead. This is a song. And it starts out, in that day shall this song be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. Salvation will God appoint for walls and bulwarks. Open ye the gates, that the righteous nation which keepeth the truth may enter in. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is strayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. Trust ye in Yahweh forever, for in Yahweh is Yahweh's everlasting strength. For he bringeth down them that dwell on high, the lofty city. He layeth it low. He layeth it low even to the ground. He bringeth it even to the dust. The foot shall tread it down, even the feet of the poor, and the steps of the needy. The way of the just is uprightness. Thou, most upright, dost weigh the path of the just. Yea, in the way of thy judgments, Yahweh, have we waited for thee. The desire of our soul is to thy name, and to the remembrance of thee. With my soul have I desired thee in the night. Yea, with my spirit within me shall I seek thee early. For when thy judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world will learn righteousness. Let favor be shewed to the wicked, yet will he not learn righteousness? In the land of uprightness, will he deal unjustly, and will not behold the majesty of Yahweh? Yahweh, when thy hand is lifted up, they will not see, but they shall see, and be ashamed for their envy at the people. Yea, the fire of thine enemies shall devour them. Yahweh, thou wilt ordain peace for us, for thou also hast wrought all our works in us. Yahweh, our God, our lords, beside thee, have had dominion over us, but by thee only will we make mention of thy name. They are dead, they shall not live. They are deceased, they shall not rise. Therefore hast thou visited and destroyed them, and made all their memory to perish. Thou hast increased the nation, Yahweh, thou hast increased the nation. Thou art glorified, thou hast removed it far unto all the ends of the earth. Yahweh, in trouble have they visited thee. They poured out a prayer when thy chastening was upon them. Like as a woman with child, they draweth near the time of her delivery, is in pain and crieth out in her pangs. So have we been in thy sight, Yahweh. We have been with child, and we have been in pain. We have, as it were, brought forth wind. We have not wrought any deliverance in the earth. Neither have the inhabitants of the world fallen. But your dead will live, Yahweh. Their bodies will rise. Let those who dwell in the dust wake up and shout for joy. Your dew is like the dew of the morning. The earth will give birth to her dead. Come, my people, enter into thy chambers, and shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself, as it were, for a little moment, until the indignation be overpassed. For behold, Yahweh cometh out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. The earth also shall disclose her blood, and shall no more cover her slain. It clearly mentions who is being raised from the dead. The righteous nation, the ones who are just. Please see the playlist Justice and Righteousness if you haven't. Those who trust in Yahweh, whose mind is on Yahweh, basically those who belong to Yahweh, his people are raised. Jesus said he doesn't know them, to people who don't do Yahweh's will. Doing his will is how we get to know him. Habakkuk 2 verse 2. And Yahweh answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. But at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it procrastinates, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not be late. Behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. Yea, also, because he transgresseth by wine, he is a proud man, neither keepeth at home, who enlargeth his desire as hell, and is as death, and cannot be satisfied, but gathereth unto him all nations, and heapeth unto him all people. The just will live by his faith. Those practicing justice and righteousness will live. Those who transgress will have death. Daniel 12 verse 1. At that time, Michael, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. There will be a time of distress such as has not happened from the beginning of nations until then. But at that time, your people, everyone whose name is found written in the book, will be delivered. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness, like the stars forever and ever. So we see that everyone in the book of life will be delivered. Exodus 32 verse 33. And Yahweh said unto Moses, whoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. Do you think most Christians have sinned against Yahweh? They think they are, quote-unquote, saved. But Yahweh says that if you sin against him, you're going to be blotted out of the book. Nothing changed from the Old Testament. The law was not done away with. Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, prophesied in song in Luke 1, verses 67 to 80, that Yahweh has raised his prophets that they would be saved in order to be delivered out of the hand of their enemies to serve Yahweh without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him, all the days of their life. Verses 74, 75. And verse 79, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. There are verses here that speak on the remission of sins. But Jesus taught us the way to that remission was praying to our Father, asking for forgiveness from him. Does it look like these people thought that they were going to be atoned for in such a manner that all their sins would be forgiven, past, present, and future sins? No, they expected to have to walk in holiness and righteousness before God all the days of their life. Acts 10, verse 34. Then Peter, Kepha, began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but in every nation he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. The word for righteousness is basically righteousness and justice. It means both. That is the common theme. We are to walk set apart, holy, righteously, and justly. This is what is accepted by God. And for those who want to say that we are righteous because of Jesus, The book of 1 John refutes that. 1 John 3, verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness and justice is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, or made known to the world, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. We are not counted as righteous because of Jesus. We are counted as righteous when we actually do righteousness and justice. And whoever is not doing righteousness is not of God. Whoever is not doing righteousness and is not just is not of God. So does it sound like we got atoned for in such a way that we don't need to keep doing righteousness and justice? Jesus told us the way to eternal life is to keep the commandments. The way inside of the gate is to do God's will. Jesus says in Revelation, to those who overcome will sit on the throne. Does it sound like he thinks that those who get in are just covered by his blood? Ezekiel 18, verse 20. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. Well, that's really interesting because, of course, it said earlier that if you sin against God, then your name is taken out of the book of life. Let me start again here at the beginning. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The Son shall not bear the iniquity of the Father, neither shall the Father bear the iniquity of the Son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. But if the wicked man turns from all his sins, which he has committed, and observes all my statutes, and practices justice and righteousness, he shall surely live, and he shall not die. There's that justice and righteousness again. Yahweh said others will not cover your sins. Yes, he sent Jesus to show us the way. He showed us the truth. He guided us on how to live. How to live in righteousness and justice. But Jesus didn't get rid of your sins. He showed you how to repent of your sins, and Yahweh gets rid of them when you let Yahweh convict you of your sins. You can also see my video, Snake on a Pole, Moses' Bronze Serpent Bible Study, Turning Jesus into an Idol. It wasn't the serpent that saved them, even though they idolized it later on. It was Yahweh who saved them. The serpent just got them to come to God in faith and be healed. Jesus gets us to come to God in faith for healing. If we didn't have to keep up with the commandments, why does Revelation have us keeping them? Revelation 14:12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Revelation 21, verse 7. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and they will be my children. But the fearful, the unbelieving, and the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars, shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. I know many so-called Christians who lie. It says all liars will have their part in the fire. All liars. Once again, I believe everyone will be saved eventually. The point is that some people don't make it into the kingdom as God's children inheriting all things, and the people who don't make it in are those who sin, which many so-called Christians still do. It's clear the Bible says that those who do righteousness and justice, which means they're considered blameless before Yahweh, will be the ones who are saved and risen from the dead, while there is justice from God. So if God never wanted us to eat animals and never wanted us to kill animals, then why would he command people to kill animals for quote-unquote atonement. If Yahweh said we have to do righteousness and justice and keep the commandments to be saved, what is up with all these sacrifices for atonement? I'm reading this book, Who Wrote the Bible, by Richard Elliot Friedman. He talks about how they found so many problems with the assumption that Moses wrote the five books of Moses. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Moses is a major figure, but it also detailed his death. There were passages that referred to him in the third person, used terms he wouldn't have known, described places where he had never been, and used language that reflected another time and locale from that of Moses. The early writers who would bring this up got their books on the Catholic Index of Prohibited Books list. One person also listed the phrase, to this day, as being in those five books of Moses, but it didn't sound like someone who was a contemporary writing it. It sounded like someone who, many, many years later, is saying, to this day, you know. From Who Wrote the Bible, quote, investigators found that in most cases, one of the two versions of a doublet story would refer to the deity by the divine name, Yahweh, formerly mispronounced Jehovah, and the other version of the story would refer to the deity simply as God. That is, the doublets lined up into two groups of parallel versions of stories. Each group was almost always consistent about the name of the deity that it used. Moreover, the investigators found that it was not only the names of the deity that lined up, they found various other terms and characteristics that regularly appeared in one or the other group. This tended to support the hypothesis that someone had taken two different old source documents, cut them up, and woven them together to form the continuous story in the five books of Moses. Skipping down a little bit, scholars found evidence that there were not two major source documents in the Pentateuch at all. After all, there were four. Two scholars found that in the first four books of the Bible, there were not only doublets, but a number of triplets of stories. This converged with other evidence involving contradictions and characteristic language that persuaded them that they had found another source within the Pentateuch. Skipping ahead, for working purposes, the four documents were identified by alphabetic symbols. The document that was associated with the divine name Yahweh or Jehovah was J, was called J. The document that was identified as referring to the deity as God, in Hebrews, Elohim, was called E. The third document, by far the largest, included most of the legal sections and concentrated a great deal on matters having to do with priests, and so it was called P. And the source that was found only in the book of Deuteronomy was called D. Skipping ahead. Graf concluded that the J and E documents were the oldest versions of the biblical stories, for they and other early biblical writings were unaware of matters that were treated in other documents. D was later than J and E, so Deuteronomy is later than the Jehovah and the Elohim. For it showed acquaintance with developments in a later period of history, the Deuteronomy did. And P, the priestly version of the story, was the latest of all. For it referred to a variety of matters that were unknown in all of the earlier portions of the Bible, such as the book of the prophets. But Vatkay, meanwhile, concluded that J and E reflected a very early stage in the development of Israelite religion, when it was essentially a nature-slash-fertility religion. He concluded that D reflected a middle stage of religious development, when the faith of Israel was a spiritual-slash-ethical religion, in short, the age of the great Israelite prophets. And he regarded the P document as reflecting the latest stage of Israelite religion, the stage of priestly religion, based on priests, sacrifices, rituals, and law. So I haven't read much further than that, but basically it looks like the priestly information we have in the Old Testament is what was added last. Much of what the early followers of Yahshua were against were things from the priestly information that was added last to the Pentateuch. In fact, Jesus seems to be against the priestly information too. I'll leave a link below to a Karaite Jew who was talking about this situation. The Pharisee Jews would wash their hands religiously. It was a man-made tradition. They would then pray about God commanding them to wash their hands right after they did it to finish the ritual. And the man in the video asked them, where in the Torah does God command that we wash our hands like this? And they said, it's not in the written Torah. The Pharisees believed they had the right to make rules for God. In Matthew 15, Jesus was showing them to be hypocrites. They asked why the disciples were not washing their hands when God had never commanded them to do so. Jesus responds, saying that by their man-made traditions of washing their hands, they have made Yahweh's law into no effect because they are following doctrines of men. They are no longer listening to God's commandments, such as honoring their fathers and their mothers when they say that they will give money to the temple. In verses 5 to 6, he talks about that. So then he goes on about how their hands don't need to be washed to eat food. The Pharisees had these man-made laws that they were, you know, looking at Jesus, trying to figure out if they could accuse him of breaking them. And then whenever they do, Jesus shows that those man-made laws are against the Torah. Yahweh would not make a law that would go against the Torah. Thus, that rule about the money being diverted from parents was not made by Yahweh. It's been theorized this is Jesus telling us that there are man-made rules we need to get rid of. Anything that goes against the commandments is not of God, because God would not be divided against himself. In Matthew 12, the Pharisees once again try to catch Jesus on one of their man-made laws about not working on the Sabbath. Jesus didn't break the commandments because helping others is okay on a Sabbath. Taking care of each other, you know, is okay on a Sabbath. It's made for resting and not working like heavy labor and things like that. But they just picked some food and casually ate it. Matthew 12, verse 1. At that time, Jesus went on the Sabbath day through the corn. His disciples were hungered and began to pluck the ears of corn and to eat. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto him, behold, thy disciples do that which is not lawful to do upon the Sabbath day. But he said unto them, have ye not read what David did when he was hungered, and they that were with them, how he entered into the house of God and did eat the shewbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, neither for them which were with him, but only for the priests? Or have ye not read in the law how that on that Sabbath days the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless? Instead of saying the commandment means not to do heavy labor and continue to go on to explain why it was okay to do what they were doing, he shows them that they're hypocrites and shows that the order that only priests can eat showbread might not have been of Yahweh. I don't know for sure, but I find it interesting that when Jesus was showing the Pharisees that they were hypocrites, it was because of laws made by the priestly order rather than Yahweh's own laws. In Acts 7, there is a speech by Stephen, but from older texts, it's far more likely that this was actually James the Just speaking. Because of his death, he was actually attacked by Paul, too, in a similar manner. But also his death of stoning went like this, and he said, forgive them, they know not what they do. I'll leave a link below if you want to look into it. But it's interesting, James was Jesus' brother. And James's name is actually Jacob, Yaakov. So it says Jacob the Just on that page. So in Acts 7, it's most likely James, who was the leader of the early followers of Yahshua, as evidenced in Acts 15 at the council. They waited on James' decision on everything. And if you've been watching the series on the Nazarene Acts, James was telling Peter / Kippa to report back to him every year, especially every 7 years. So in Acts 7, he's talking to the Sanhedrin about their past and Jesus being the prophet who was to come. Acts 7, verse 35. This Moses, whom they refused, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge? The same did God send to be a ruler and a deliverer by the hand of the angel which appeared to him in the bush. He brought them out. After that he had shewed wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, and in the Red Sea, and in the wilderness 40 years. This is that Moses, which said unto the children of Israel, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me, him shall ye hear. This is he that was in the church in the wilderness with an angel which spake to him in the Mount Sinai, and with other fathers who received this the lively oracles to give unto us, to whom our fathers would not obey, but thrust him from them, and in their hearts turned back again into Egypt, saying unto Aaron, make us gods to go before us. For as for this Moses, which brought us out of the land of Egypt, we know what has become of him. And they made a calf in those days, and offered sacrifices unto the idol, and rejoiced in the works of their own hands. Then God turned, and gave them up to worship the host of heaven, as it is written in the book of the prophets, O ye house of Israel, have ye offered to me slain beasts and sacrifices by the space of 40 years in the wilderness? Yea, you took up the tabernacle of Moloch, and the star of your god Renpham, figures which ye made to worship them, and I will carry you away beyond Babylon. Our fathers had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness, as he had appointed, speaking unto Moses, that he should make it according to the fashion that he had seen, which also our fathers that came after brought in with Jesus into the possession of the Gentiles, whom God drave out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David, who found favor before God, and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. But Solomon built him in a house. Howbeit the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet, Heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. What house will ye build me, saith Yahweh, and what is the place of my rest? Hath not my hand made all these things? Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, as your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted, and they have slain them which shewed before of the coming of the Just One, of whom ye have been now the betrayers and murderers? It goes on for him getting stoned to death. God kept sending them prophets, and they kept killing them. But I digress. The point here is that in the desert they made the golden calf, and God gave them up to worship their idols and not him. So in the desert, when they were sacrificing animals to a god, it was not him. He gave them over to have the tent or tabernacle of Moloch and the star of Renpham. And in verse 44, it seems to say that God was making, had appointed Moses to make the tabernacle of Moloch. I've also heard it say that the golden calf was just a cow's head, and there's also pictures you can find of what looks to be like the cow's head that they would offer their children to. So when Moses was receiving the commandments, they may have been creating this idol of Moloch with the head of the calf where they could offer their babies, to burn their babies. Perhaps they were doing that when Moses came down and crushed the commandments. They would just burn their children to Moloch. They, you know, offered them up. And then they would make all sorts of noises and it was their fertility, right? You know, and that's sort of what we see when Moses comes down. Exodus 32, verse 1. And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods, which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, that man that brought us out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what is become of him. And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings, which are in your ears of your wives, and of your sons, and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people brake off the golden earrings which were in their ears, and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hand, and fashioned it with a graving tool, after he had made it into a molten calf. And they said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation, and said, Tomorrow is a feast to Yahweh. And they rose up early on the morrow, and offered burnt offerings, and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and to drink, and rose up to play. And Yahweh said unto Moses, Go, get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made them a molten calf, and have worshipped it, and have sacrificed thereunto, and said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which have brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And Yahweh said unto Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. And Moses turned and went down from the mount, and the two tables of the testimony were in his hand. The tables were written on both their sides. On the one side and on the other were they written. And the tables were the work of God, and the writing was the writing of God, graven upon the tables. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people, as they shouted, he said unto Moses, There is a noise of war in the camp. And he said, It is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither is it the voice of them that cry for being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. And it came to pass, as soon as he came nigh and unto the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing. And Moses' anger waxed hot, and he cast the tables out of his hands and brake them beneath the mount. And when Moses saw that the people were naked, for Aaron had made them naked unto their shame among their enemies, I'm going to quit reading there. But the people were naked, and they were singing and dancing. I read online that Moloch's fertility goddess consort is Ashtaroth, a.k.a. Astarte. If this is the case, it is not surprising that they were naked too, because of the whole fertility rites. I have also heard that people would sacrifice children to pagan gods in order to gain fertility, which seemed counterproductive to lose their child for fertility. And I think that they would actually sometimes engage in sex, when they were doing these sort of things. I don't know why you would lose your child to then try to have another child. I may be wrong about them trying to have, more fertility with children versus maybe just a more fertile ground for crops. That might be all it was. I'm not sure on that. You guys can do your own studying on that part. From Catholic.org sacrifice page. Quote, to the cruel god Moloch, sacrifices of children were offered, a horrible custom against which the Bible so sternly inveighs. The kindred cult of the Phoenicians originated in a low idea of the deity, which inclined towards gloominess, cruelty, and voluptuousness. We need only mention the worship of Baal and Astarte, phallism, that's the worship of phallics, and the sacrifice of chastity, the sacrifice of men and children, which the civilized Romans vainly strove to abolish. In their sacrificial system, the Phoenicians had some points in common with the Israelites. The sacrificial table of Marcellus, which, like the similar sacrificial table of Carthage, was of Phoenician origin, mentions as sacrificial victims steers, calves, stags, sheep, she-goats, lambs, he-goats, fawns, and fowl, tame and wild. Sick or emaciated animals were forbidden. The Phoenicians were also acquainted with holocausts, kalil, which were always supplicatory sacrifices and partial offerings, which might be sacrifices of other supplication or thanks. The chief efficacy of the sacrifice of men and animals was regarded as lying in the blood. When the victim was not entirely consumed, the sacrificers participated in a sacrificial banquet with music and dancing. So, I'm thinking that that is what was going on. The music and dancing and fertility rites, being naked and all that. I believe that golden calf was Moloch, and they were sacrificing to Moloch while Moses was getting the commandments. From deliriumsrealm.com's page on Moloch. Quote, rabbis claim that in the famous statue of Moloch, there were seven kinds of cabinets. The first was for flour, the second for turtle doves, the third for an ewe, the fourth for a ram, the fifth for a calf, the sixth for a beef, and the seventh for a child. It is because of this Moloch is associated with Mithras and his seven mysterious gates with seven chambers. When a child was sacrificed to Moloch, a fire was lit inside the statue. The priests would then beat loudly on drums and other objects so that the cries would not be heard. I've heard that they made a lot of noise. Like I said, so the cries wouldn't be heard here, but, they would shout and things like that. So the singing and all that could have been, related to this. That could be why God was so upset that they were making such a noise from the camp, because the noise was to drown out the cries of the child. The noise is like, you're going through with a sin. And horrible sin, but you're going through with a sin, And then you're trying to, like, lie to yourself or not focus on the fact that you're sinning. What was upsetting him is that they know it's wrong. That's why they're doing the singing and the drums and everything. So it's the noise that they're doing to cover up the fact that they know it's wrong. You know, it's the covering up of their conscience, the searing their conscience with a hot iron, basically. The singing and noise and, you know, drums and everything was the actual act of searing their conscience because they know it's wrong. Otherwise, they wouldn't be doing all this noise, trying to, you know, drown out the noise of a child being killed, burned to death. And interestingly enough, all the sacrificed animals to Moloch here are like animals we see Yahweh asking for in the Old Testament, which seems to say these animals were never, you know, asked for by Yahweh. They just called Moloch Yahweh. You know, they made the golden calf and called it Yahweh. And they said, this is going to be our God instead. They used the same name. So when they say that Yahweh was asking for it, it's actually Moloch that was asking for it. So all these sacrificed animals, the same ones that Yahweh is saying. And then, you know, the Israelites said they were doing it to Yahweh. That's their actual quote. They were doing it to Yahweh. And most likely they just added this information into the scriptures later. It got all confused about which Yahweh are they talking about, because they called Moloch Yahweh and then they called Yahweh Yahweh. So, you know, that's how we get all these scriptures in the Bible that say, you know, Yahweh asked for this when he never did. They were calling two different gods Yahweh and then writing that into the scriptures, in my opinion. Jeremiah 19 verse 3. And say, hear ye the word of Yahweh, O kings of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Thus saith Yahweh of hosts, the God of Israel. Behold, I will bring evil upon this place, the which whosoever heareth his ears shall tingle, because they have forsaken me and have estranged this place, and have burned incense in it unto other gods, whom neither they nor their fathers have known, nor the kings of Judah, and have filled this place with the blood of innocents. They have built also the high places of Baal, to burn their sons with fire and burnt offerings unto Baal, which I commanded not, nor spake it, neither came it into my mind. Once again, Baal, Moloch, I mean, it's probably the same thing. They're just using different words when they're writing this information into the scriptures. And Yahweh is saying that their fathers had never known these gods. The kings of Judah had never known these gods. And then he combines that with, and have filled this place with the blood of innocents. So Yahweh seems to be implying here that the kings of Judah and their fathers had never filled this place with the blood of innocents. They had never done these sort of sacrifices to their God, because their God was Yahweh. But these people who came out of Egypt, their God was Moloch or Baal, and then they just called Moloch or Baal Yahweh and then wrote that into the scriptures. And so they confused that, you know, the older generation had worshipped the same God. That's why it looks like it in the Bible. But that's not what's really going on. Yahweh is saying that they never did this. They never knew this. It never even entered, you know, Yahweh's mind to have them do this. So he never would have asked them to do it. And they didn't even know those old gods. They were worshipping the true Yahweh. If it didn't even come into Yahweh's mind to burn babies to him, why do we think it came into his mind to burn his babies to him? God is our Father, but he's also the Father of all creation. He created us all, and the same living spirit, or ruach, of God is inside of us all, even the animals. Animals are called nephesh, so these animals can call him their Father too. Psalm 148:7. Praise Yahweh from the earth, ye dragons, and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and vapor, stormy wind fulfilling his word, mountains and all hills, fruitful trees and all cedars, beasts and all cattle, creeping things and flying fowl, kings of the earth and all people, princes and all judges of the earth, both young men and maidens, old men and children, let them praise the name of Yahweh, for his name alone is excellent. His glory is above the earth and heaven. So this is saying that, you know, Yahweh created everything, and Yahweh is everything's Father. Be it fire or hail or dragons or trees, cedars, beasts, cattle, creeping things, flying fowl, and he waits until the end to list the humans. You know, it's interesting. You know, the animals were the ones who are just sort of going on instincts, and if they could, they would be following Yahweh's ways and not eating meat, you know. And we are the ones who are doing things that we don't need to be doing. We're killing when we don't need to be killing, you know. So he lists us last. But basically, even the animals are going to be praising Yahweh. So, you know, we shouldn't be surprised. Also, you know, the donkey spoke, and Jesus said that the rocks could sing. If everybody else was quiet, the rocks would sing. We know that the animals have Yahweh's breath of life in them, just as we do, and we were created from the dirt, the clay of the earth. So if the rocks are from the earth too, God can put his spirit inside of them whenever he wants to and make them sing, make them alive, if they're not alive already. I mean, how do we know what's really going on here? And Jesus would say even the rocks would start singing. And a prophecy yet to happen, God makes a covenant with the animals. Hosea 2 verse 14. Therefore, behold, I will allure her and bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. And I will give her her vineyards from thence, and the valley of Achor for a door of hope. And she shall sing there, as in the days of her youth, as in the day when she came up out of the land of Egypt. And it shall be at that day, saith Yahweh, that thou shalt call me Ishi, my husband, and shalt call me no more Bali, my lord. For I will take away the names of Baalim, Baal, out of her mouth, and they shall no more be remembered by their name. And in that day will I make a covenant for them with the beasts of the field, and with the fowls of heaven, and with the creeping things of the ground. And I will break the bow and the sword and the battle out of the earth, and will make them to lie down safely. So he's going to make a covenant with the animals at that time. And they're going to lie down safely. It means they're not going to be worried about being sacrificed anymore. Also, the word for Baal means Lord. So, or the word for Lord was Baal back then. So they were trying to call Yahweh their Lord, like Lord over them. And this Lord that they worshiped, that they called Yahweh, that wasn't Yahweh, would ask them to do sacrifices. And that's what they were attributing to Yahweh in the Old Testament. But Yahweh never wanted to be called Lord. He didn't want to be called Baal. He didn't want to be lording over them. He wanted to be their husband. He wanted to be Ishi, you know, my husband. That's what they're supposed to be saying. And, you know, now we have the Old Testament has Yahweh's name written throughout it, and then they never wanted to say Yahweh's name, right? So what did they say instead? They said Lord. And Lord is the word for Baal. So the whole time they've been trying not to say the sacred name, they've been worshiping Baal by attributing everything to Baal, to their Lord. Yahweh doesn't want to be known as Lord. He wants to be known as, you know, husband. And that's why we see the Old Testament, every time it says Yahweh, they changed it, even in our English translations, to the Lord in all caps, or God. Yahweh always wanted his name to be known. He's very clear about it. He never wanted people to be substituting his name for something else. So it's going to be a big deal when he gets back, when people actually call upon his name, Yahweh. I mean, we're not worrying about the pronunciation here, but they'll be taught his name again, and they're not going to have the word Baal come out of their mouth anymore. They're not going to be calling him the wrong name anymore. Also, I heard that the newer versions of the Bible are using the name Jesus less and focusing on the word Lord more in order to get the interest of other religions who just want to listen to Jesus' teachings, like those who would follow Krishna instead and just attribute Jesus' sayings to him. I heard the whole Krishna equals Christ debate where people say that Jesus is Krishna, but I mean, you know, people come up with all these different things. Christos just means anointed, or Christ. That's the word for anointed. But if this is true, it seems likely that the Antichrist beast that everyone would be worshiping might be called the Lord. Yahweh was clear he wants his name to be known throughout the world, but most of the mainstream religions would be perfectly fine just calling him the Lord. At this point in time, anyway. But back to the point, they worshiped Moloch in the desert because God allowed it. They worshiped in the tabernacle of Moloch. And James's speech makes me wonder if Yahweh ever asked them to even build him a tent or a temple. I don't think he did. I think that Moloch might have asked for a temple or a tent, but I don't think Yahweh actually asked for anything like that. But I'm going to continue to study. There is also an interesting study, and I'll leave the link below, on the image of the beast being the Ark of the Covenant. We were told not to create images of anything in heaven or earth, and they had the angels on the ark, which seems to go against the commandments. And so, like I said, man-made doctrines that go against the commandments, Yahweh wouldn't have been asking. He wouldn't go against his own commandments. You know, divided against yourself, you're going to fall. He wouldn't do that. So I can see a situation in the future where they worship in the tent or temple with the Ark of the Covenant, and that could be the image of the beast. So check out Terah Family's video, The Image of the Beast, and also Armageddon and the Parousia, which was so fascinating I wanted to do a whole video on it, but I haven't had time, so please check it out yourself. Terah Family's really interesting. I would suggest subscribing to them. Amos 5 verse 22. Though ye offer me burnt offerings and your meat offerings, I will not accept them. Neither will I regard the peace offerings of your fat beasts. Take thou away from me the noise of thy songs, for I will not hear the melody of thy vials. But let judgment run down as water, and righteousness as a mighty stream. Have ye offered unto me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness 40 years, O house of Israel? But ye have borne the tabernacle of your Moloch, and Sheon, your images, the star of your God, which ye made to yourselves. Therefore will I cause you to go into captivity beyond Damascus, saith Yahweh, whose name is the God of hosts. I wonder about that last bit. It might be the God of gods, you know, the stars. The angels were known as sons of gods, or, you know, little g gods, fallen angels were. So that might just be the God of gods. So Yahweh is trying to tell them that the God of gods never asked you to do this stuff. I don't want your meat offerings. I don't want your burnt offerings, basically. He wanted them to repent, but he knew they weren't. And I'm sure it was, you know, frustrating, to say the least. It seems like Yahweh was pretty clear that they were worshiping for 40 years in the wilderness the wrong God. And we know that they named that wrong God Yahweh. It's been asked, how would they have the time and patience and ability to add in all the sacrificial priestly stuff without ruining the rest of the flow of the Bible? Well, they had 40 years back then. I mean, that seems like a pretty good time. God had given them over, hardened their heart or whatever, gave them over to worship the wrong gods. And by worshiping them, they started sacrificing the animals and children, perhaps. Well, we know they did sacrifice children, just I'm not sure about the timing, but this seems like it makes sense. And the demons would have been running rampant in them. As soon as you sin, and these blood sacrifices are great for witchcraft, bad for us, great for the demons, though. Demons are very clever, and they know just the right words to use. They could have easily added in the phrases that people, you know, added to the Bible if those people were oppressed or even possessed at that time. With all that blood sacrificing, witchcraft, it sure seems like they definitely could have been open to possession at that point in time. So they could have easily changed the scriptures that they had back then to say the same Yahweh was asking for the sacrifices. You know, they were mixing them up. And at this time when they got out of Egypt, is when the texts say that they decided the high priests would always come from the tribe of Levite. Doesn't it make sense that the high priest is not from the tribe of Levite now? You know, people weren't really sure why that was, but it makes sense to me now, because Yahweh never asked for the high priest to be of the tribe of Levite, in my opinion, based on just this study and even going through this video, things are coming to my mind. You don't have to believe me, like I said. Just pray to God to figure out the truth. because he is the one who can lead you to the truth. Romans 14, verse 20. Do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food. All food is clean, but it is wrong for a man to let his eating be a stumbling block. It is better not to eat meat or drink wine, or to do anything to cause your brother to stumble. Keep your belief about such matters between yourself and God. Blessed is the one who does not condemn himself by what he approves. But the one who has doubts is condemned if he eats, because his eating is not from faith. And everything that is not from faith is sin. So many people believe Paul is talking about all food being clean now. But we know that that would go against the Torah and turn Paul into a false apostle. Others believe he is saying that unclean meats are not considered food at all. So all food is clean is a reference to all clean meats and all nuts and berries, etc. are good to eat. But then in verse 21, the word for meat is referring to flesh in particular. He's saying it's better not to eat flesh or drink wine if it causes a brother to stumble. 1 Corinthians 8 is all about Paul saying that they know it's all right to eat meat sacrificed to idols, so long as you have faith that it is okay. But he says that if others would be offended, don't do it. Which is basically his message about being a Jew to the Jew and Greeks to the Greeks. He'll be a vegetarian to vegetarians. So the reason Paul is writing this is because some of his brothers in Christ were refusing to eat meat. And Paul mentions it a lot. Why was Paul so concerned with followers of Yahushua abstaining from meat? Many of the early followers of Yahushua did not eat meat. Actually, it's very possible even John the Baptist did not eat meat. Here's a clip from Stephen Bannoun's wife, Yana, in Israel, discussing what John was probably eating instead of bugs that were called locusts.
Hi guys, I'm here in Israel, and here on the floor I found a lot of beans of carob. Now, carob tree is known here in Middle East as a Saint John's bread, for the reason that the Eastern Christians believe that Saint John's, when he was in wilderness, he did not really eat locusts. You know how our traditions, Western traditions, say that Saint John's ate honey and locust, and we, in our minds, believe that he ate bugs. He basically probably baked or roasted his bugs and he ate them with honey. Well, that is really not true, because according to very first documents and beliefs of Christians that lived around this area, he ate carob. Carob tree is known as a locust tree. So maybe the translators forgot to put the word tree in their translation. He ate honey and locust tree fruit, or fruit of the locust tree. And as I did research on carob, I found out that it's full of vitamins, minerals, amino acids, and basically what is protein. So it has everything human body needs, and you can survive on this alone. So when Bible says that he ate locust tree or fruit of the locust tree and honey, that's true. I mean, he could literally survive in a desert on this. What the Middle Eastern tradition about carob, they use it a lot here in Middle East, and they make flour out of it, and they bake these cakes with honey. So maybe this was the diet of Saint John, and I personally believe that this is his diet, and he didn't really dine on bugs. You might want to do more research on this, but here on the floor we have a lot of carob beans. When I open it, they definitely smell like cocoa, and they resemble cocoa. So, and I also bought some flour for myself and some carob paste to put on the bread, and it is delicious. It is also extremely healthy food. So, Saint John had an extremely healthy diet, guys. Okay, well, this is Yana from Israel, and shalom to you.
There is also only one verse in the Bible that says Jesus ate meat. It was after his resurrection. In Jerusalem, supposedly, he appears to the disciples and asks for something to eat, and eats fish and honey. There is no second witness account of this, and personally, I'm starting to have doubts he showed up in Jerusalem after his death, but rather showed up in Galilee, since there are conflicting reports of where he showed up first. A lot of the writings from the early followers of Jesus have been lost, but we have a lot of writings from early Catholics. I certainly think that there's a reason for that. The Catholics had invented a list of books to not read, and were killing true followers of Yahshua simply because they didn't believe the same things as the Catholics did. If you had to choose who was a true follower and who had an Antichrist spirit in that situation, it's obvious that the Catholics killing people simply because they don't agree with them were of an Antichrist spirit. And those who would rather die than recant their beliefs were true followers trying to stick to the truth. So it's no surprise that we don't have much in writing from these early followers who didn't eat meat. But we do have some documents from people, like Catholics, who denounced the early followers as heretics. I've been trying to find out the original Matthew Hebrew, if it's anywhere online. It doesn't seem like it. There is a Hebrew Matthew out there, which may be interesting to study, but I think that one has had revisions too. But Epiphanius wrote some books in a series to combat the heresies of the day, as he viewed them. So I'll read some of his quotes on the early followers of Yahshua, and I'll leave a link below if you want to study it for yourself. But remember, he thinks they are heretics and is trying to paint them in a very bad light, and he can misconstrue what their true beliefs are at times, just to make them look bad. Not all of the groups listed are early followers of Yahshua. I'm going to focus on the Essenes, Nazareans, Osaeans, Nazareans, and Ebionites. Some of these, if not all of these, are the same group with a name that sounded differently, or maybe it just had multiple names by different people. He doesn't mention the meat eating with the Essenes, but, you know, Essenes, Osaeans, it could have been the same group. They have very much in common with other groups, so they are likely the same. On the Nazareans, part 18, it says they kept the same Sabbath and observed the same festivals. Quote, 1:4. And so, though they were Jews who kept all the Jewish observances, they would not offer sacrifice or eat meat. In their eyes, it was unlawful to eat meat or make sacrifices with it. They claim that these books are forgeries and that none of these customs were instituted by the fathers. End quote. From part 19 on the Osaeans, quote, 3:6. And notice the craziness of the fraud. He bans burnt offerings and sacrifices as something foreign to God and never offered to him on the authority of the fathers in law. And yet he says we must pray towards Jerusalem where the altar and sacrifices were. This man who rejects the Jewish custom of eating meat and the rest and the altar and fire as something foreign to God. End quote. From part 29 on the Nazareans, quote, 5:3. He arrived there during Passover and observed their customs, and how some of them put off eating throughout the holy week of Passover, though others ate every other day, and others indeed each evening. But all this has been written by Philo on the subject of Christians' faith and regimen. End quote. From allcreatures.org, a page entitled Jesus Was a Vegetarian. Quote, Irenaeus, on the other hand, born between 115 and 142 CE and dying sometime after 191 CE, is the first person to speak of the Ebionites as a heretical group, which would later be identified as vegetarian, and points out that they used only water and bread and not wine at their Eucharist. This, he says, they do because they reject the idea of the divine and human nature existing in Christ in perfect union, the water representing human nature and the wine representing the divine nature. So right here he's saying the Ebionites were denying that Christ was divine, like God, on earth, so they weren't drinking the wine at the Eucharist. Of course, I've come to this conclusion that Jesus is not God. I have many videos on it if you haven't seen those, but, you know, it's interesting to see everything that I'm coming to by the Holy Spirit is leading me to these people, and they have like the same beliefs that I have been having. So it's very, very interesting and exciting to study them. What I'm going to continue on here. What Irenaeus fails to report is any vegetarianism practiced by the Ebionites. Interestingly, later when Epiphanius writes about the Ebionites, he does mention the fact that they are vegetarians. The question is then, did Irenaeus not mention the vegetarianism because it was not something seen as done only by heretics, but done by all Christians at the time? For example, around the same time as Irenaeus, another famous early church father was writing. His name is Tertullian. it would appear that some Christians were beginning to eat meat and claim that Christ and his apostles ate meat. We know this because Tertullian wrote against this idea on his On Feasting or Abstinence Against the Carnal Minded. He holds Daniel in high regard for his choice in vegetable foods and water. We can see that Tertullian did not mince words when it came to his description of his fellow Christians who ate meat. So Tertullian is in this time period where most Christians are vegetarians, and he's writing against those Christians who are starting to eat meat. Quote, "Your belly is your god, your liver is your temple, your paunch is your altar, the cook is your priest, and the fat steam is your Holy Spirit. The seasonings and the sauces are your chrisms, and your eructations are your prophesyings." End quote. Continuing on with the larger quote here from this page, of course, there were other Gnostic-type groups that practiced vegetarianism at this time, and they would pop up again throughout the history of the church. And then it goes on about the Gnostics. EarlyChristianWriting.com has a page entitled Gospel of the Ebionites. Since we don't have that gospel, this page is just a collection of what Epiphanius wrote concerning the Ebionites. Once again, he was Catholic and trying to say the Ebionites were heretics. Quote, "And on this account, they say that Jesus was begotten of the seed of man and was chosen, and so by the choice of God he was called the Son of God from the Christ that came into him from above in the likeness of a dove." I just want to point out that he is trying to say that this is heretical, but the Bible says that God anointed Jesus with his Holy Spirit, which the dove was the Holy Spirit of God coming down into Jesus. So God was anointing Jesus with his Holy Spirit, and Christ means anointed. So, you know, Jesus became Christ when the Holy Spirit came down into him, and God anointed Jesus as the Christ, because Christ is anointed. He became the anointed one. That's what I came to before I ever read this stuff. Epiphanius is trying to say that this is totally nuts, but that's really what the Bible says if you actually study it out. Continuing on with Epiphanius's quote, "And they deny that he was begotten of God the Father, but say that he was created as one of the archangels, yet greater, and that he is Lord of the angels and of all things made by the Almighty, that he came and taught, as the gospel so-called current among them contains, that, quote, I came to destroy the sacrifices, and if ye cease not from sacrificing, the wrath of God will not cease from you," end quote. So I just want to point out that, once again, he's going off about how, you know, he thinks that Jesus was begotten of God at his birth. They're denying the divinity of Jesus, which of course I do. and they also say this thing, I've had people say this to me before too, that if you deny that Jesus was God, then you have to say that he was created like an angel. And that doesn't make any sense. He was created like men and women are created. That makes sense. He was a man. He was supposed to. Yahweh prophesied through the prophets that he would raise up a prophet like Moses among Moses's brethren. You know, otherwise you turn God into a liar for saying that the prophet is going to be like the brethren of Moses. You know, he was created like all men were created. That doesn't turn him into an archangel. The Bible is very clear that God raised Jesus up when he was dead, and he was raised to have power, authority. He was granted power and authority by his obedience above the angels. So he didn't have to be an archangel to have authority over the angels. The whole point of the Bible is that God, raised him up above the angels, and we're told that we're going to be raised up above the angels too. In Revelation, when Jesus says, if you overcome, you'll sit with me on my throne, as he was sitting on his father's throne. So the throne is the authority over all creation. So by that, we would be just the same. But you know Catholics. So anyway, continuing on with his quote here. With reference to the Passover and the evasion of the idea that Jesus partook of flesh, they have changed the saying, as is plain, to all from the combination of phrases, and have made the disciples say, Where wilt thou that we make ready for thee to eat the Passover? And him, meaning Jesus, forsooth, say, have I desired with desire to eat this flesh of the Passover with you? It's a bit weird and cool that the Holy Spirit has led me to these things, like Jesus being begotten at his baptism and not eating meat and needing to repent to be saved before I looked into all this. So this is all just a confirmation that God is actually working through me as he was working through the disciples back then after Jesus. From Essene.com, quote, according to the writings of the early church fathers, Jesus, his brother James, the apostle Peter, and the other disciples were vegetarians. We read also in Aramaic Matthew that Jesus would not eat the traditional Passover meal, which of course contained meat. According to the church historian Hegesippus, St. James, the brother of Jesus, was, quote, holy from his mother's womb, and he drank no wine nor strong drink, nor did he eat flesh. They're saying James the Just didn't eat flesh at all. In the Clementine homilies, St. Peter wrote, I live on bread alone with olives and seldom even with pot herbs, and my dress is what you see, a tunic with a pallium, and having these I require nothing more. Further, one ancient church writing containing the teachings of St. Peter states, the unnatural eating of flesh meats is as polluting as the heathen worship of devils. With its sacrifices and its impure feasts, through participation in it, man becomes a fellow eater with devils. We should also note that Clement of Alexandria said the Apostle Matthew partook of seeds and nuts and vegetables without flesh. St. Basilius the Great claimed, quote, the body which is burdened with meat is afflicted with diseases. A moderate way of living makes the body healthier and stronger and cuts off the root of evil. The stream of meat, meals, darkens the light of the spirit. One can hardly have virtue if one enjoys meat meals and feasts. End quote. St. Gregory of Nazianzen says, quote, the debauchery in meat meals is an infamous injustice. End quote. The Apostle Thomas was also a vegetarian, as we see when we read the following from the Acts of Thomas. Quote, that which he eateth is bread and salt, and his drink is water from evening unto evening. End quote. Other apostles are recorded as having also been vegetarians. In fact, the evidence reveals that all the early Christians were vegetarians. End quote. Whether or not all of these writings should be considered canon is besides the point. The point is that the early Christians were described as not having eaten meat. This would be very weird to see a bunch of stuff written about them being vegetarians if they had actually eaten meat. From Enjoy the Vegetarian, quote, in 383, Jerome, 347 to 420 after Christ, got the order from Pope Damascus I to set up a standard Latin Bible text. The Vulgate is his creation. Skipping down. Jerome still knew about the vegetarian or Christendom. Jerome was vegetarian and an animal lover. He became famous and popular due to a story with a lion which he removed a prickle out of his paw in the desert Chalcis in Syria. Jerome and the lion were friends from now on. Jerome had all writings about the doctrines of Jesus which were available at this time. He well knew Jesus did not eat meat. Jesus taught to love the animals and not to kill them. In a letter to Juvian, Jerome made it clear, quote, the consumption of animal meat was unknown until the flood, but since the flood, fibers and stinking juices of animal meat had been stuffed into our mouths. Jesus Christ, who appeared as time was achieved, associated the end with the beginning again, so that it is us not allowed any more to eat animal meat. At another part in the same letter, it is said, quote, and so I tell you, if you want to be perfect, it is subserve to eat no meat. End quote. From the point of view of modern Bible scientists, Jerome also translated the so-called Hebrew Gospel, of which just a few parts are passed down. The following verses are written there. Quote, follower, where do you wish us to prepare the Passover meal? Jesus, did I demand to eat meat with you at Passover? Pesha? End quote. Other ancient writings beyond the Bible also testify that Jesus and his followers did not eat meat, and that the early Christ lived vegetarian as well. Nonetheless, Jerome misapplied, or had to misapply, this important aspect of Jesus' doctrine at the composition of the Bible, or he adopted already falsified models. The consequences of this concealment are unimaginable for animals, for nature, and for human beings. Main point of contention: the love of animals of the Nazarenes. Apparently, the vegetarianism of Ur-Christs was a huge problem for the mighty at that time. After the death of Pope Damascus, Jerome ran away from Rome because of his espousal of vegetarianism, and he fled to Bethlehem in 385. He would have feared for his life if he had included Jesus' truthful love of animals in his retranslation of the Bible into Latin. Fluid plum was poured in the throat of vegetarian and pacifist Christs already under Emperor Constantine. The following citations should throw light on the dark force which took possession of the doctrine of Jesus up from this time. The new Catholics were forced to enunciate accursedness against the followers of Jesus and Jesus' doctrine, consequently against Jesus as well. Quote, "I execrate the Nazarene, these obstinate people, which negate that the sacrifice law was given by Genesis. This law contains to eat living creatures." End quote. In 314, the following decree was given at a church synod in Ankara. Quote, "It was decided that those who were priests and deacons in spirituality and who avoid meat have to taste it. If they show averseness and not even eat the meat together with vegetables, they have to be excluded from office." End quote. Karsten Strelo, vegetarianism/veganism as a part of the Ur-Christendom. Pope John III, 561-574, even execrated the vegetarian on the first synod of Brig. If somebody thinks that meat meals, which God gave the people for consumption, are impure and renounce them, this person should be banished. Paul had problems with vegetarianism. The apostles lived vegetarian and vegan respectively. Just Paul had problems with this. He preferably did not want to expect nothing of people so that they convert to Christendom as soon as possible. The vegetarian way of living was inconsiderable for him. The Ur-Christs faced him with mistrust and refusal as Paul has chased them and has arrested many women and men. He was seen as a mock apostle. Therefore, he mainly evangelized at the heathen. There he was very successful as he did not disclose the nourishment rules and did not call for realization of the Jesuanic doctrines. He just called for the faith in Christ. Of course, he knew about the vegetarianism of the Ur communities, but he described this as a weak faith. The church bases with preference on the following citation of Paul. Quote, "Whoever whatsoever is sold in the shambles, eat, asking no question for conscience's sake." 1 Corinthians 10:25. However, Paulus's second conversion came apparently later, or he did not want to argue about this subject with the Ur-Christs constantly. He confessed then, quote, "It is good not to eat flesh and not to drink wine, nor anything whereby thy brother is offended or scandalized or made weak." End quote. Romans 14:21. And, quote, "Wherefore, if meat scandalizes my brother, I will never eat flesh, lest I should scandalize my brother." End quote. 1 Corinthians 8:13. Finally, he attested, "Jesus instructed me to eat no meat and drink no wine, but only bread, water, and fruit, so that I be found pure when he wants to talk to me." Tol dot Jeshu, cited according to Carl Anders Skyver, Ways of Living of Christ, of Jesus and the First Christs. Page 121. I just want to point out that Toldot Jeshu paints Jesus as a magician and a chaser of women, adulterer, or whatever. It's just, you know, you can look that up, but I don't know about that quote. It doesn't seem right to me. But who knows? Anyway. And continuing on, but this avowal came too late. His letters already worked a circuit and threw a bad light on the doctrines of Jesus. No animals had to die as the first Christs came together to eat and drink in community, because Jesus of Nazareth had elucidated his followers about the sensation of animals and assigned them not to slaughter animals. What are the consequences of Bible falsification? Reams of human beings and animals had and still have to suffer from the falsification of Jesus' doctrine. 1,000 years ago, hundreds of thousands of misbelievers have been slaughtered in the sign of the crucifix, during the Crusades until the Crusaders were walking in blood up to their knees. During the Inquisition, millions of people have been tortured and burned under the crucifix. Today, dead animals lie in front of the crucifix, and church and catechism issue their blessing for this. Animals have no soul, after all, according to the doctrine of the church. Therefore, reams of animals have to pay with their lives due to the falsified doctrines for centuries, day after day. As Jesus, the Son of God, was crucified 2,000 years ago, then the creation of God is crucified today. Millions and billions of animals are held in mass hutchins under cruel circumstances and are slaughtered, partly without anesthesia, or are even thrown into boiling water, with the explicit blessing of the church. Millions and billions of animals suffer and die the whole year in labors of animal experiments, with the explicit blessing of the church. All 6 seconds an animal dies because of a hunter in Germany, with the explicit blessing of the church. But not with the blessing of God, for sure, because God said to the people in the creation history, quote, "Behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed upon the earth, and all trees that have in themselves seed of their own kind to be your meat." 1 Genesis 29. Skipping down. Other writings than biblical writings prove that Jesus and his followers were vegetarians. Quote, "Christ abstained from meat nutrition at all," end quote. Polinius, in a letter to Trajan, and you can look it on the screen. One point is they're saying Christ's with an S, because we are all anointed in the body of Christ. We are all anointed with the Holy Spirit. That's what Jesus did. So we are all considered Christ's. And I guess they knew that back then. If you say that today, people will call you a heretic. Anyway, quote, "As for my sacrificial offerings, they sacrifice meat and eat it, but Yahweh does not accept them. Now he will remember their iniquity and punish their sins." Hosea 8:13. Quote, "He who slaughters an ox is like one who kills a man," end quote. Isaiah 66:3. Quote, "When you spread out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood." Isaiah 1:15-1:17. Petrus, the Peter. Quote, "I live on bread and olives, to which I only seldom add a vegetable," end quote. That's from the Clementine homilies. Paul, quote, "Jesus instructed me to eat no meat and drink no wine, but only bread, water, and fruit, so that I may be found pure when he wants to talk to me," end quote. This is that Toldot Jeshu quote again. Like I said, it paints Jesus as a magician who harassed women. This quote is probably a complete fabrication, especially since it goes against Paul repeatedly saying that eating meat is okay. Continuing on, quote, "Matthew lived on seed, the fruit of trees, and vegetables without meat," end quote. Clemens von Alexandrian. Quote, "Jesus never ate meat." Church historian Hegesip, according to Eusebius, History of the Church, 2:2-3. Quote, "Jacob, the brother of the Lord, lived on seeds and plants and touched neither meat nor wine." Oh, that's from the Epistle ad Faustum. 22:3. And John Chrysostomus, 354-407, about a group of exemplary Christians, quote, "No streams of blood flowed at their place, no flesh was slaughtered and cut to pieces. One does not smell there the awful vapor of meals of meat. One hears no racket and terrible noise. They eat only bread, which they earn through their work, and water that a pure spring offers them. When they want a lavish meal, then indulgence consists of fruits, and they find thereby higher enjoyment than at the royal tables." From Homily 69. And Clemens of Alexandria, 150-215, quote, "For within a moderate simplicity is there not a diversity of healthy foods, vegetables, roots, olives, herbs, milk, cheese, fruits, and many kinds of dried foods. Among the foods, one should favor those that can be directly eaten without the use of fire, for they are always ready for us and are the simplest. Accordingly, the Apostle Matthew lived from seeds, hard-shelled fruits and vegetables, and ate no meat. And John, who practiced modesty to the utmost degree, ate the buds of leaves and wild honey. I think that the blood The bloody sacrifices were invented solely by those people who sought an excuse for eating meat, which they also could have had without such idolatry. End quote. From Pedagogus 2. Gregory of Nazianz, church father from Capodazin. Quote, but the seed of a good house father is the good wheat from which he bakes bread. The indulgence in meat dishes is a disgraceful wrong, and I desire that you may strive to offer your soul nourishment that lasts eternally. End quote. Hieronymus 3:48-420. Quote, it is better that you eat no meat and drink no wine, for drinking wine started with eating meat after the great flood. Innocent foods are foods acquired without letting blood. Consuming meat, drinking wine, and overfilling the stomach are the cradles of greed. From Adversus Jovinam 130. So you can look up all these quotes yourself. I thought that was interesting, the innocent foods are foods acquired without letting blood, because I talked at the beginning of this video about how holy is something that is innocent and of God, and what is holy is not letting blood. Continuing on, Basilius the Great, 330-378. Quote, the body that is burdened with meat foods is plagued with illnesses. A moderate style of life makes it healthier and stronger and cuts off the root of evil. The vapors of meat foods darken the light of the spirit. It is hard for one to love virtue when one is gladdened by meat dishes and festive meals. End quote from Demonic Institute 910 Epistle. Quote, meat is a contradiction to food, and it belongs to the world of the past. End quote. That's from the Clementine Homilies 3:45. Quote, as long as one lives frugally, the luck of the house will increase. The animals will be safe, no blood will be shed, and no animal will be killed. The cook's knife will be useless, the table will only be set with fruits which nature offers to us, and one will be satisfied with that. End quote. From the Epistles of Basilius the Great, 330-379. Wild animals get their name from their wild nature, not because they were created evil from the very beginning. Instead, the sins of man made them bad. For since man was diverted from the path, they also followed him. If now man again raises himself to an existence fitting to his nature and no longer does evil, they too will return to their original gentle nature. From Theophilus of Antioch, second half of the second century. And as I've said earlier, this doesn't have to be considered inspired writings to prove the point that people were talking about the early followers of Yahshua as vegetarians, and that it was weird when the followers started eating meat. And it wasn't just them that said God never wanted sacrifices. We have lots of Bible verses that say this. Micah 6, verse 1. Hear ye now what Yahweh saith. Arise, contend thou before the mountains, and let the hills hear thy voice. Hear ye, O mountains, Yahweh's controversy, and ye strong foundations of the earth, for Yahweh hath a controversy with his people, and he will plead with Israel. O my people, what have I done unto thee? And wherein have I wearied thee? Testify against me. For I brought thee up out of the land of Egypt, and redeemed thee out of the house of servants. And I sent before thee Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what Balak, king of Moab, consulted, and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him from Shittim unto Gilgal, that ye may know the righteousness of Yahweh. Wherewith shall I come before Yahweh, and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old? Will Yahweh be pleased with thousands of rams, or with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He hath shewed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth Yahweh require of thee, but to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. So he's saying he doesn't want thousands of rams, he doesn't want all this oil, he doesn't want firstborns, he doesn't want people to sacrifice their children. And that's what people were doing, was sacrificing their children for the sins. They were trying to appease God for their sins by sacrificing children. And he's saying, that's not what I wanted. What do I require of thee but just to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly before me? Psalm 50, verse 7. Hear, O my people, and I will speak. O Israel, and I will testify against thee. I am God, even thy God. I will not reprove thee for thy sacrifices or thy burnt offerings to have been continually before me. I will take no bullock out of thy house, nor he-goats out of thy fold, for every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon 1,000 hills. I know all the fowls of the mountains, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell thee, for the world is mine, and the fullness thereof. Will I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? Offer unto God thanksgiving, and pay thy vows unto the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. Once again, God is saying, he created everything. All these animals are his. You know, the whole earth is his. He doesn't want his creation to be killed. He doesn't want to drink the blood of goats. He created the goats. Why would he want them dead? He's the one who gave them life in the first place. He just wants thanksgiving and people to call upon his name when they're in trouble. And then people will glorify him. And that's what he wants, he wants us to be humble before him and to love mercy and be just, righteousness and justice. You know, that's the point. A Psalm of David, Psalm 40, verse 6. Sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears hast thou opened. Burnt offering and sin offering hast thou not required. He's specifically saying that Yahweh never required that stuff. So if stuff is happening in the Bible in the time of David, where he's sacrificing things, then that's got to be, you know, planted in there. Hebrews 10, verse 8. Above when he said, sacrifice and offering and burnt offerings and offering for sin, thou wouldest not, neither hast pleasure therein, which are offered by the law. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first that he may establish the second. He's taken away the old laws, the man-made laws, about sacrifices, so that he can establish the second, the whole point, what he's always wanted, is us to do his will. It says, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. Jesus came to do God's will, not his own will. Because Jesus asked, you know, please take this cup from me. He was saying, why did you forsake me when he's dying? And it wasn't Jesus' will to die, you know. He was supposed to do God's will, which is to, you know, just walk humbly and be righteous, be the king. And then they just killed him for it. And we are supposed to do the same thing. We're supposed to sacrifice our own wills and do God's will instead. Romans 12, verse 1. Therefore I urge you, brothers, on account of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you will be able to discern what is good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. So, when you are conformed, when you are dying to your sin, dying daily to your sin, and choosing to do God's will instead, you're going to find out what is good and pleasing and the perfect will of God. He's going to show you, if you truly want to know. Hosea 6, verse 6. For I desired mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings. We get the knowledge of God by doing his will. That's how we get to know what he likes and what he doesn't like. When you're doing God's will every day, when you're asking him to show you what he wants you to do each day, then when you do those things, you're going to find out, he didn't have me do this for a few weeks. I guess he doesn't like that. Or, you know, he's been having me focus here. I guess he really wants to, you know, get this information out or whatever, you know. When you're doing his will, you're going to see who he is, what he is like. That's how you get the knowledge of God. And he desired mercy, like we talked about earlier, that second confirmation. Yahweh desires mercy, not sacrifices. Like from Micah 6 verse 8, he hath showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth Yahweh require of thee, but to do justly and love mercy, to walk humbly with thy God. Righteousness and justice, mercy and self-sacrifice, be living sacrifices. He doesn't want dead sacrifices. He's the God of the living, not the dead. And just, you know, think, if we're supposed to be giving mercy to people, aren't we not supposed to be giving mercy to animals? Is it really merciful to kill an animal for food when God gave us the berries and the nuts and everything? You know, just something to think about. The ruach of an animal is the same as the ruach of a man or a woman. The Bible uses the same word for animals and for us, nephesh, a living soul. And God breathed that life into us. Genesis 9, verse 2. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth, and upon every fowl in the air, and upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you. Even as the green herb have I given you all things. But flesh with the soul or nephesh thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall ye not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require, at the hand of every beast will I require it. And at the hand of every man, and at the hand of every man's brother, will I require the life of man. And talking about blood of animals, Leviticus 17 verse 14, for it is the nephesh, or soul, of all flesh. The blood of it is its nephesh slash soul. Therefore I said unto the children of Israel, ye shall eat the blood of no manner of flesh. For the life of all flesh is the blood thereof. Whosoever eateth it shall be cut off. Jubilee 6:7. But flesh with the life thereof, with the blood, ye shall not eat. For the life of all flesh is in the blood, lest your blood of your lives be required. At the hand of every man, at the hand of every beast, will I require the blood of man. I understand it seems to be saying that we can eat animals. But on the other hand, there's always blood in your meat. If there's always blood in your meat, then you're disobeying him. I don't know how they were able to get the blood out if they had a different technique or whatever, but when you have, you know, any kind of meat, there's blood, especially red meat, when you see all the juices coming out and everything. If we're eating blood of an animal, that's disobeying God. If Jesus was preaching the end of the sacrifices and vegetarianism, it's interesting that Paul was preaching quite the opposite. You know, James the Just was in charge of the early followers of Yahshua, and he never ate meat. And he was called just because of his righteousness and justice, and believed in the law. And Paul is accused of going against the law, and actually takes the Nazarite vow and does a sacrifice. Acts 21, verse 18. And the day following, Paul went in with us unto James the Just, and all the elders were present. And when he had saluted them, he declared particularly what things God had wrought among the Gentiles by his ministry. And when they heard it, they glorified Yahweh and said unto him, Thou seest, brother, how many thousands of Jews there are which believe, and they are all zealous of the law. And they are informed of thee, that thou teachest all the Jews which are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, saying that they ought not to circumcise their children, neither to walk after the customs. What is it thereof? The multitude must needs come together, for they will hear that thou art come. Do therefore this, that we say to thee, We have four men which have a vow on them. Them take and purify themselves with them, and be at charges with them, that they may shave their heads, and all may know that those things whereof they were informed concerning thee are nothing, but that thou thyself also walkest orderly and keepest the law. As touching the Gentiles which believe, as we have written and concluded that they observe no such thing, save only that they keep themselves from things offered to idols, and from blood, and from strangled animals, and from fornication. Then Paul took the men, and the next day, purifying himself with them, entered into the temple, to signify the accomplishment of the days of purification, until that an offering should be offered for every one of them. Numbers 6:13. And this is the law of the Nazarite. When the days of his separation are fulfilled, he shall be brought unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and he shall offer his offering unto Yahweh, one he lamb of the first year without blemish for a burnt offering, and one ewe lamb of the first year without blemish for a sin offering, and one ram without blemish for peace offerings. So Paul is okay with people doing sacrifices of animals, and he's okay with people eating animals. There seems to be a difference of opinion between Paul, who says it's okay to eat meat sacrificed to idols, and other people. In Revelation, Jesus is against eating meat sacrificed to idols. Revelation 2, verse 14. But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. Acts 15, verse 27. Therefore we are sending Judas and Silas to tell you in person the same things we are writing you. It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us not to burden you with anything beyond these essential requirements. You must abstain from food sacrificed to idols, from blood, from the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality. You will do well to avoid these things. Farewell. Find it interesting they mention not to eat meat from strangled animals. Basically, I think how an animal is killed really does matter. I think that the fear the animal goes through may actually live on in the blood, because the life is in the blood. If you have a life that's been terrorized and that, you know, animal dies, then that terror is living in the blood, that their life is in the blood. And when you eat it, you're probably taking that in. Today, the large companies pack the animals in. They don't feed them well. They feed them hormones to make them grow more meat, but that's not healthy. They basically torture the animals to make money. Like, some animals will have problems with their feet, just be so heavy, but their feet are not, you know, off balance and things like that. If you look at the animals and just think about if what they're feeling when you're looking at them is still in the blood, and then you put that in you and it like becomes you, like you are what you eat, it becomes you. You know, do you really want to be putting that fear inside of you? I guess that's one of the main things that you should be thinking about, but there's another thing coming up. So they're basically torturing these animals to try to make more money. They're, you know, doing everything they can to make more money. They will, you know, not pay as much money to keep the animals happy if they can make more money. So the reason I'm making this video really comes down to this. Mammon is the pagan god of money. Jesus says you cannot serve two masters. You either serve the one or you hate the other. You can't serve God and mammon. You can't serve God and serve money. If you're serving money over God, you know, you're worshiping an idol. And the people who raise animals and feed them unhealthily, coop them up, torture them their whole lives, and then kill them are basically sacrificing the meat to idols, the god of mammon. So if you eat meat from one of these production places, I would suggest that you think about Jesus telling you not to eat meat sacrificed to idols. Now, you don't have to agree on anything I said in this video, but Jesus told us to not be eating meat sacrificed to idols, and it seems really important. So I'm just suggesting that you pray on it. You know, you don't have to listen to anything I said. I'm going to leave lots of links below, and you can check those out. Study to show yourself approved to God, and pray on it. Pray to God to find out the truth. Pray to not be deceived, because you don't want to be one of those people that ends up, you know, being deceived simply because you love your meat too much or something. You know, I mean, I know people are like that. They don't want to listen to the Holy Spirit convicting them of something because, you know, they're going to feel either ostracized. I mean, if you told your family, oh, you're vegetarian now because of your religious convictions, they might call you crazy. Only few find the way anyway, right? Or people don't want to stop eating meat, and so they won't listen. Oh, but they'll pull out these verses, but this verse and this verse and this verse, you know, they are using the Bible as an idol. They're using the Bible as an idol of you know, wood, paper, basically. A tree was cut down, made a book, and now you're going to these verses trying to find, but you know, reasons why you can keep eating meat, or reasons why you can keep, you know, doing what you're doing. In general, people use the Bible as an idol from time to time if they are not listening to the conviction of the Holy Spirit that is inside of them. In the end, we know that there's going to be a grand delusion for everybody who doesn't love the truth. So it comes down to this. Can you actually say to yourself that you love the truth? Do you love the truth more than anything else? Do you love the truth more than eating meat? Do you love the truth more than any of your pet sins that you don't want to get rid of? Do you love the truth more than, you know, being called crazy by your family? Or do you love the truth more than people in religious groups looking at you weird and calling you a heretic? You have to love the truth more than anything if you don't want to be deceived. 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 9. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness and unrighteousness, of unrighteousness, in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them a strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. We need to have righteousness and justice. And we need to love the truth. And we need to pray to not be deceived to be saved. We have to pray to God to lead us to the truth and actually listen to the Holy Spirit convicting us. So I pray that you will pray on this. Thank you for listening, and shalom.